His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace.
May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. Be His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. Be His praises come before you. Beside you, all around you, and within you, He is in you, He is in you, in the morning, and the
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to St. Andrew's this morning. My name is David. I'll be leading you in worship this morning. But first, let's pray together before we begin our time of worship. Father, we love you and we thank you so much for you and that you sent your son for us. And today, as we take time to honor that through the taking of communion later in the service, I pray that our minds would already be there. We would already be thankful as we're worshiping you that you came to save us and that you came to demonstrate the love that you have for us. In your name, amen. All right, why don't you stand and join with us this morning as we begin. Together. Father, I thank you that we can come together like this and we can remind ourselves, we can remind each other of the things that you've done for us throughout our lives. And we can look back throughout history and see the things that you've done. not just for us, but for the people who came before us. And we can trust that you're faithful because of that, because you don't fail. And not only do you not fail as a great God, you don't fail as somebody who came down to earth and who loves us and who sent his son for us. In your name, amen. All right, well, you may be seated.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Reverend Gary Rideout, one of the co-senior pastors here at the St. Andrew's United Methodist Church, along with my wife, Jane. And we are so glad that you're here today and so glad you could join us on the live stream, too. We ask that you, if you bring up the Church Center app and maybe register your attendance at this time or register your presence. Any prayer concerns that you may have, please note them there, and I can guarantee you they will be prayed for. And if you're out on the live stream, do the same thing. Go into chat space, tell everybody hello, good morning. Text somebody who's telling, let them know their worship has started. They need to join us. Today is Communion Sunday, so we hope that everybody at home get their bread and their juice together to prepare for that. And hopefully you all got a communion cup this morning. So we're excited about our worship this morning. It's a lovely day, a wonderful day. But also I want to take a couple of things that's coming up. Of course, Easter's coming up. The week before Easter is Holy Week. And typically there would be a Stations of the Cross activity. But because of the pandemic, cannot do that in person, so you can do the Stations of the Cross at home. So these little Stations of the Cross Lenten boxes have been put together. And this Stations of the Cross is an invitation to journey with Christ during the Holy Week and at each step to the way to the cross. So you can experience, try to experience what Christ went through for us. If you want one of the Stations of the Cross Lenten boxes, you can register for it. You can register for that on the app or at saumc.life. And then you can pick them up starting next week before and after the services so that you complete the experience during Holy Week. So we're excited that you're here. We're excited for this time of worship. So let's continue our worship together.
All right. Well, why don't you guys stand and join us again as we continue.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty? So much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
You sing, this is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Back into order, who calls the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
All right, let's sing out.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my fall. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
And this morning, let's just remember to be thankful to God, especially as we're observing communion, that he did provide that grace for us. You know, Ephesians 2, 8 through 10 says we're saved by grace through faith for the purpose of good works. But we don't get to the being able to serve until we love, right? Till we see the love of God demonstrated to us. And that's through his grace that he draws us to him. So this morning, wherever you are, if you're here with us, if you're watching online, let's just keep our minds focused on being grateful for the sacrifice that Christ has made for us. And because of the fact that he is the Lamb who was slain, we can sing the next song, that we are no longer slaves to fear. We're no longer slaves to our past, but we're children of God. So let's sing this together.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemy. Till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name, and I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins, and I'm now.
Split the sea.
You split the sea so I can walk right.
Sing that together.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God again. I'm no longer a slave to fear. 'Cause I am a child of God.
Father, we thank you that we can say that, that we can find our identity in you as your children, not in all of the other things that distract us and the other things that can pull us away. We find our identity in the one who doesn't fail. And I pray that this morning that we would just be overwhelmed with that love that you've shown us, and that we would respond by being faithful to you. In your name, amen. You may be seated.
I am Jane Rideout. I'm the other, you know, Gary and Jane together for many years, and I'm so happy to be with you in worship today. Whether you're here in the building or you're at home on the couch or your bed or whatever best, we're so thrilled to worship with all of you. Our scripture lesson this morning is about fear, and I'm going to read it to you in a minute, but I want you to hear this first because sometimes we don't see what the scriptures really, there's some underlining things going on here, but this is a scripture that's actually about fear. And I think it's really relevant to us because fear is a reality, right? We all have fear. There's different times. There's big fears, there's little fears, but we all have fears. And we know that fear is like not a good thing. And I love the song we just sang because we all want to be released of our fears, right? But even Christians have fears. It's just, even though we believe in Jesus, we still have fears. And so it's important to talk about them because fear leads to stress and anxiety, depression, and even physical realities. Fear's a tough one. And I think in different levels, most people have to struggle with it. I went looking for a study to see, like, what is, you know, what do Americans fear? And of course, because of COVID, I couldn't find any recent studies. But I found back one from back in 2019. And some of the top fears of Americans are corruption, pollution, people we love becoming sick, polluted drinking water, people we love dying, air pollution, cyber terrorism, not having enough money for the future, global warming. Those are, for some people, those are these big fears here that maybe you don't think about every day. But then there's the personal fears, the stuff we deal with day in and day out, you know, that are connected to our family. So this past weekend, I had the honor and privilege of going to the confirmation retreat at Warren Willis. We have 17 kids in the class, and 14 of them were able to go on this retreat. I just got back last night. And talk about fear. There is nothing scarier than teenagers. I mean, there's just a reality there. So I get there, and I have my bag and my pillow, and I go into the dorm, and they've already picked all their beds, and I have to have a bottom bunk. And I'm thinking, no one wants to be Mivy. No one wants to be by her. You know, that's no fun. You don't want to be by the old lady. You want to be with your friends. And then my biggest fear is, what if I snore? Oh, my gosh, what if I snore? And so, you know, I get all set up, and at night I put my little strip on my nose to help me not to snore and go to sleep. And the next morning I wake up, and I think I'm kind of good. And half of the girls are still there, and I said, did I snore last night? And they all start laughing. There's my answer. And but then they were kind. They said, well, it wasn't too long. It eventually stopped. You know, that is life. We all have fears, right? Big fears, little fears. but we still have fear. And so that's why I think this scripture is just really important. So I'm going to start reading to you. This is out of the book of John chapter 9. And it's kind of a familiar story. As Jesus walked along, he saw a man who was blind from birth. And Jesus' disciple asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned so that man was born blind, this man or his parents?" And Jesus answered, "Neither he or his parents. This happened so that God's mighty works might be displayed in him. While it's daytime, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I'm in the world, I am the light of the world." After that, he spit on the ground, made some mud with saliva, and smeared the mud in the man's eyes. And Jesus said to him, "Go and wash in the pool of Siloam." So the man went away and washed, and when he returned, he could see. And the man's neighbor and those who used to see him when he was a beggar said, "Isn't that man who used to sit and beg?" Some said, "It is." And others said, "No, it's someone who looks like him." But the man said, "Yes, it's me." So they asked him, "How are you able to see?" And he said, "The man they called Jesus made mud, smeared it in my eyes, and said, 'Go to the pool of Siloam and wash.' And so I went and washed, and then I could see." And they asked, "Where is this man?" And he replied, "I don't know." This is a really great story. In fact, it's a great story, but through the years when I'd heard preached on, theologians used to, the response to, like, why did the disciple ask that, used to be a little different. That first response used to be, they said that was all about the Old Testament. Because in the Old Testament, there were teachings that were kind of clear. Like, if you were obedient to God, you were blessed, and if you were disobedient to God, you were cursed. And that teaching is in the Old Testament because God was trying to teach the Israelites how to be obedient, how to be followers of one God, and to be holy. But I don't think that's actually the full story, because people in the Old Testament were very smart, and they also knew other stories that were circulating. Those were stories of, like, Job. Job is like the most righteous guy in the world, the person who does everything right, and he had horrible things happen to him. People are smart, and so those Old Testament people, I think they kind of knew that. So here is another possibility for why the disciples said, "Who sinned, that man or his parents?" Maybe he was just afraid. What do I mean? You see, when we see things like blindness, we want to blame it on something. If we see horrible things happen, we want to blame it on something. We want to know, how did that happen? What did they do? And we think, we don't say this out loud, did they take care of themselves? Were they healthy? Were they dealing with their issues? We always want to know why a person is the way they are, because if something random happens, that scares the heck out of us. We want a reason why they're ill, so we can distance ourselves from it, because we're scared of that. We're fearful. Randomness scares the heck out of us. That's why even people of faith get scared and struggle with fear, because we understand that life is unpredictable and there's a randomness to it. And that makes us really, really uncomfortable. I noticed it with COVID. When people started getting COVID, what did we say? "Where'd you get it? Who gave it to you?" We almost want to blame somebody. And I'm like, who the heck cares where you got it? You have COVID. And that's kind of just like, oh, I can always, I'm going to do different. I'm different. That won't happen to me. That's what's been so scary about COVID, because it can happen to a lot of people. So now let's return to our story. Why the heck did Jesus heal the man the way he healed him? I mean, he gets down and he spits in the mud and then takes that mud and spit and puts it in his eyes and then says, "Go to the pool of Siloam and wash it out." The man is blind. You know, is that really the right way you do it? I would be like, just heal him on the spot. Don't make him go do that. But you're kind of like, what is Jesus doing? This is also a cultural thing. This is actually the most loving thing that Jesus could do. You see, back in that first century, in ancient times, they believed that saliva had healing powers. And so what Jesus was doing is he was entering into the world of the blind man, understanding that the man would understand. That would make sense. Saliva heals. I mean, think about even now, whenever you cut yourself or you burn yourself, you stick it in your mouth, right? That's kind of what you do. Well, they really believed it healed. And so the man would be comfortable with this. You know, we find it strange, but the man would think, yeah, that's a good idea. And so Jesus was actually meeting him right where he was. That's pretty amazing. It was in terms the man could understand. Missionaries and going out into the world has changed a lot over the last 20, 30 years. It used to be there was this thinking that you would just keep going to the same place every year. Let's take our trip back to wherever we go, and we just keep going back, and we help them. And we work for 1 or 2 weeks, and then we come home. And now we're beginning to realize that sometimes didn't always work. In fact, we were doing some damage going back and forth. Because missionaries now know you need to just go and move into the neighborhood. You actually need to go and get to know the people, understand their lives and how they live and what is their thinking and understanding. You start there. In fact, we're not even really supposed to share the love of Christ until you get to know somebody. That's why we don't stand in corners and pass out flyers. You need to be in relationship with people. Meet them where they're at. And you do that first before you share the love of Jesus. You show the love of Jesus first. You meet them where they are. So I want to go to another verse too. So a lot of times when I read scripture, I read something and I don't like it. I mean, let's be honest. Sometimes you read scripture like, that doesn't sound so good. And that's okay. It should make you curious, and you should go maybe to a commentary and read about it so you understand it better. And then one of the ones in this one that I don't kind of like would be verse 3. I'm going to read it to you. They've just talked about the blind man and Jesus said, no, neither he sinned or his parents. And then he says this. This happened so that God's mighty works might be displayed in him. Okay, that's a problem for me right there. Did he just say that Jesus caused it or God caused it? I went to different translations because I didn't think that was really accurate, or I really kind of struggle with that one. But I liked a translation called The Message. It's a very loose translation, but I think this gets closer to what is correct. The Message said this. Jesus said, you're asking the wrong question. You're looking for someone to blame. There's no cause and effect here. Look instead for what God can do. I like that. I think that's a better translation. No one was to blame. But now let's see what God does. Because that's what is most important. So I want to also, there's another verse too that talks a little bit about light, where Jesus says, while I'm here, I am the light. Sometimes we're missing some stuff in here. There's references to the Old Testament. I want you to have the richest understanding of this story. When Jesus was talking about light, it immediately kind of takes us back to the creation story in Genesis. And in Genesis, the first chapter, God tells us how he created the earth, but it's in poem form. It's a poem. And really what you learn in there is that God, out of chaos, brought order. And the word that he connects to chaos is darkness, and the word he connects to order is light. And so God took darkness and he fixed it with light. Let me read to you that scripture. When God began to create the heavens and the earth was without shape or form. It was dark over the deep sea, and God's wind swept over the waters. God said, let there be light, and the light appeared, and God saw how good the light was. God separated the light from the darkness, and God named the light day and the darkness night. So he's talking about chaos to order and darkness to light. So what is chaos? Chaos is any of the pain and suffering we know in this world. That man, that blind man, understood chaos. His life, he was a beggar. That's the way he survived. That was what his job was. It's all he could do. He knew chaos. He knew darkness. But the amazing part of this story is that God was the answer. Jesus was the light, and he was the answer to the darkness. You know, when we think of chaos, or another name for it is evil, it's a little bit frustrating. On the confirmation retreat, we had at the very end, we let them write questions about church or something they've always wanted to ask, but we had them write it down because, you know, they might get intimidated. They're still young. And we answered all the questions. We had to put them all in a baggie, and we answered them. It was me and Ryan and Patty, everybody working, and Paul. We were answering the questions. And then we were all done, and we said, And they would ask questions like, you know, some of them were deep, some of them were not. Like, you know, in the communion bread, have you already cut it a little bit? Because it kind of looks like it breaks pretty clean. I like that one. So, you know, it was just kind of a good time to talk about the truth. Yes, we do cut it halfway, so it looks good, okay? So they had good questions, but we got all done, and we someone said, is there any last question? And finally, the youngest, I'm pretty sure he was in sixth grade, raises his hand, and he says, why do people suffer? And I was like, bingo, that's the best question. Because, yes, sixth graders think about that. And seventh graders and eighth graders, because everybody lives in the world and they are seeing suffering. They know there's pain. They know there's chaos. And here's the deal. Back in that poem that we learn about creation, it acknowledges darkness. It acknowledges chaos. But it never explains it. It never lays it out and says, well, this is why evil exists. It's not there. You're not going to find that in Scripture. Evil is always acknowledged. It is not addressed. But this story helps us understand what we're supposed to do. How do we respond to evil? Well, we bring healing. St. Andrews really understands this. There's a lot of ministries here that are all about justice in meeting people in their need. We feed the hungry. We fight for the rights of those who cannot fight for them. We do all kinds of ministries here where we're actually doing that very thing because that's how we're supposed to respond to evil. That's the key. We are called to be the answer to the evil. And sometimes that overwhelms us and we think we can't do that, but we need to because evil's what we all fear, basically. Evil's the randomness of life. Evil's what keeps us awake at night, not knowing what is going to happen. That's just part of who we are. You know, I used to think, what's wrong with me? I've been a Christian like forever. And I still struggle with fear. And I don't beat myself up anymore. I stopped doing that. I've read enough that it is part of who Jane is. And I think a lot of you, that might be part of who you are. Or you might have something else. For some of you, it's fear. It's your friend. I don't like calling it my friend, but it's there. It shows up all the time. But for some of you, it might be depression. Or it might be anxiety. It might be a restlessness that, man, you can never get rid of. It can manifest itself in all different ways, and it's part of who you are. You have all these wonderful parts of you, but you also have these things you struggle with. And that's part of the chaos, too. But what I want to tell you is you don't have to beat yourself up for that. Instead, you just need to know how to respond to it. I wanted to read a scripture to you out of John 10. It's going to be in your reading next week. I hope you're still trying to read through the book of John. If you're having a hard time, please know, so do I. The first week, I didn't read for 3 days, and by Wednesday, I was like, I'm behind again. That's so me. And then the next week, I'm kind of doing it, you know, randomly, and I got to do a little catch-up now when starting this week. I just am terrible at stuff like that. And I'm married to a guy who's so orderly and just does what he's supposed to do on the right day, and I'm just not like that. I want to be like that. That's why I married him, thinking it would rub off. I want to have an orderly life, and mine just never is. So don't give up. Read when you can. Catch up as you have to, but keep reading. So next week, this is going to be in your reading. And this is just a great, great passage. It says, the thief, it's talking about Jesus as the good shepherd. It's talking about where we should, how we should handle our fears. It's giving us an image, a visual. So when we're struggling with whatever it is we struggle, when we're really feeling fear, this is what the image we need to look for. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I, Jesus, have come that they may have life, and they may have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep, but a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, the one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. The wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and does not care about the sheep. But I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I am known by my own. And the Father knows me, and even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them I must also bring. And they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. I wish fear would go away, but I'm pretty sure at this age it's going to always be a part of me. But when the fear pops up, I can say, oh, that's Jane being Jane. But I can vision the good shepherd who loves me, who seeks me out when I kind of wander away or I get distracted, who constantly pursues us, drawing us back and reminding me that we're not alone. He's watching over us. And when we do struggle, he is there to help us and to meet us in our need. Will you pray with me? Loving God, we just thank you. It's overwhelming that you love us so much, that you're there with us, that we don't have to be slaves to our fear. Yeah, fear's there, but so are you. And you are the good shepherd, and you care for us. And Father God, we ask that you will help us to remember that. And even more importantly, to remind others, to reach out to help heal those who are hurting, those who are struggling, those who are living in chaos or evil. And love on them. Help us to be those people that are the answer. And now, together with one voice and by one Spirit, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Seems like we've gone through a time of great fear and anxiety with this pandemic. And now we're going into uncharted waters again as to how do we become a church in the post-pandemic world? How do we rebuild and regroup now that we've gone through this? And we've known that God has provided for us during this pandemic. And I hope you got received this if you're on a mailing list, church mailing list. You got one of these in the mail already. And it's a celebration of where God has gone through us in these ministries during this pandemic. And also looking toward the future. Looking toward the future as to where God will lead us. And a big part of that is to move on to the future is to have a good financial is giving, have a good financial base. We need the financial base to be able to do this. So you can see in there, there's a little card there. You can give your offer your offerings or your pledge for the next year. You can give today. You can either go online to give at saumc.life on the church app, or if you're here in the sanctuary, there's baskets in the back. But the whole idea is that we're trusting in God again through this post-pandemic, and through that we are igniting hope. We want to thank you for you being so generous in these past year or so through this tough time, and I just want to give you gratitude for doing that. Thank you.
Why don't you stand and sing with us as we prepare for communion?
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. To the end of yourself, do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regret and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, know what our Savior, isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Oh, bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found. So Father, we love you. And as Jane was saying earlier, that we know that there are things that we're going to have to deal with forever in our lives just because of the state of the world that we live in. But we also know that we have hope in you as we await for the day when you make everything right. And we thank you for that. In your name, amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, David and the praise team. That was a perfect introduction to communion. Jesus is calling to come to the altar. And though we can't physically come to the altar on this day, wherever you're at right now, that's your altar. That's where you're coming. And you're going to share in the cup and the juice, the bread and the juice, as we celebrate communion together. We remember, this is a time of remembrance of what Christ did for us. We almost like a constant reminder, Christ died for our sins, was resurrected to give us eternal life. And there are many ways we can experience that in our days. There's many times we experience Christ. But this is one way Jesus told us, commanded us to do. Do this in remembrance of me. And as we share on the communion on this Sunday, In a way, it's kind of bringing in Christ again, that grace that he offers to us freely, giving to us as we partake it, take it in, that forgiving, that saving, and that amazing grace that he offers unconditionally to all of us. And remember, on the night which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread. He broke the bread very cleanly. Maybe not very cleanly that night. He broke the bread and gave thanks to God and said, "Do this in remembrance of me. This is my body." It's interesting that he broke the bread because it reminds us he takes our brokenness. We offer our brokenness to him. He takes on our brokenness. And then after the supper, he took the cup, gave thanks to God again, and said, "Do this in remembrance of me. This is my blood of the new covenant, offered for forgiveness of sins." The brokenness, but then offering forgiveness, redemption, and healing that we need. Let us pray. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world till Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Did everyone here get a cup? If not, please raise your hand. Okay. So those here in the sanctuary, peel off the top layer. I probably have the most trouble doing this. There we go. Those at home, take your bread that you have and hold it up. This is the body which is broken for you. Then take the second part of it, and then at home, take the cup. Peel off, for those who are here, the layer. Hold it up. The blood of Christ given for you. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourselves to us, to each one of us. Grant that after this time we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others, all in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Father, we love you, and we thank you for the gift of your Son, and that we can gather together, and that we can observe that we can remember you. And I pray that it wouldn't just be today, but it would be in every day of our lives. We would be thinking of acting toward others the way that you've shown your love toward us. In your name, amen. Well, why don't you stand and join with us as we close the service this morning.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace.
This morning, that we can have confidence in God, no matter what we're going through, that we can have faith in him and know that he is right beside us. So just remember that as we leave and as we go out this week, and remember to share his love with everyone we meet. Have a good week, everybody.
that you've even gone to win my war. You come back with the head of my enemy. You come back and you call.